the center. Rose, quick, march.
Driven by John Hardy and Wayne Negus. Next car out is Piffin, and at this stage we might get on to the actual grid position.
And the pole position for the time yesterday of 224.1 is the Peter and Philip Rock car for Bill Patterson race. The man who won four out of the last five and only
five. Are good. Well, probably the strongest car I've ever started the race in. It's going to be very fast, and the Ford's very strong.
The front row of the grid will be Tirana and Falcon, then Falcon, Tirana, then Tirana and Falcon again, Tirana, Tirana, a Falcon, then another two Tiranas, and then one Falcon. So the Tirana-Falcon battle is really on. They're very, very equal indeed, and that probably covers about 12
race.
Rows on the grid.
And if I'm up to it,
six
cars I'll run a fast race all day.
Rows, of course, are both evenly matched with a Tirana and a Falcon on each of those.
So I'm fairly confident with the cars looking pretty good, but you know, the race hasn't even started yet, and a lot of things can happen.
Fans are also being ushered off the grid. The drivers are in the hands of the starter. All cars hopefully will fire up. Is it going to be a Ford victory or a Holden victory? The front row of the grid is evenly matched. Waiting for the starter now to mount the starting rostrum.
The Hardie Ferodo 1077. Only a couple of pit crew remaining with the cars. What must the drivers be thinking now?
What must they be thinking? Remembering of things that have happened in the past. The first lap people, shunts on the start finish line, all that kind of thing. And that hooter was for 2 minutes to go.
Stand by for the start of the great race, the 1977 Hardie Ferodo 1000 Classic from Mount Panorama Bathurst.
Bond is outside him. The flag is in the air. The revs are also up in the air. Down comes the flag and runs away in 77 with the Hardie Ferodo 1000. All cars seem to have done.
And we'll see who's first and best dressed through the first corner. And it's a Tirana gets through there first. A Tirana gets through there second. And that could have been Price. Here's Alan Price absolutely erupting off the street to make it Holden's 1-2, Falcon's 3-4. And then the Dillon team guy in fifth position as they charge up.
Friday morning, they unload the cars. Like the actual Sunday morning race start, it's a symbolic moment, an important moment in the spectacle that is Australia's biggest motor race. The crews are committing themselves and their sophisticated production-based machines to 2 days of struggle to gain a start place.
You understand these haven't got Hardie Ferodos to control yet?
For some, the trials will be formality. For others, despair. Mechanical and organizational difficulties will put them far back from the coveted front row. Others will not even make the field. So it begins. 2 days of seemingly endless testing, of confirming handling and power calculations, of checking out new components, of bedding in tires, and above all, of getting the feel of the place. For all but these few days each October, the Mount Panorama track is a public road. In a year, things change. This race will be faster because of vehicle improvements. It's as if the learning process never stops, especially here. Especially for Holden and Ford, because this race is almost their private preserve, their confrontation, their bitter, no-holds-barred battle. Bathurst is the great leveler. It's 8 kilometers of twists, turns, hill and flat, respect no one. It's a difficult place to know well. If this is part of the ritual, then it is exhausting ritual. Finally, order develops. Out of the seemingly never-ending blur of movement and color, the start grid is set. The lame depart, the lower end of the ruck fights out the last start positions, and the fast men take their rightful positions at the head of the 60 starters. There are few rituals left to pre-stage the spectacle of the race.
Brock in the Tirana is on pole position. That is, he'll be starting in the number one spot. Colin Bond will be... That's Tirana, Falcon. Tirana and Falcon on the first...
Saturday night at Bathurst is ritual. This scene is common to dozens of garages, workshops and locations throughout the town as mechanics translate the final lessons of the trials to the race machines. The pressure is profound. There is always too much to do and never enough time to do it in. There is no room for mistakes. The slightest error, the slightest miscalculation will ruin months of preparation. There is only one ritual left. The race itself. This night, this last barrier of time to a massive national sporting event is suddenly no barrier at all. By very nature of its length, 1,000 kilometers in distance and 6 hours in time, the Hardie Ferodo 1000 is no sprint. The opening thrusts and feints last no more than a dozen laps. The running order is soon established as the leaders discover each other's strengths and weaknesses. And then the great waiting game begins.
There have been a few incidents so far, a few cars have pulled out, a couple of unscheduled stops have taken place, but up front...
Within these dozen opening laps, the leaders begin overhauling the slower cars at the tail end of the already strung-out field. Achieving an accurate overview of positions, of recognizing developing threat or fading challenge, becomes an almost impossible task for anyone but the highly experienced lap scorers and pit crews.
In the whole day, way behind. He's in big bubble.
The leaders pass the pits every 2.5 minutes. If the variance is only a few seconds, there's no cause for worry. But if the delay is any longer, it can signal disaster and the ruination of those months of preparation. So apart from the 60 driver's seats, the pits are where tension is probably highest. Yet even the strongest mind can be numbed by the regularity of the unfolding laps, the relentless passage of the race.
This means he'll lose the lead, but he should get it back when the other front runners make their stop. The Belgian Grand Prix driver, Jackie Ickx, will take over. The Gos Pescarolo car is also in. There's Negus. The lead Durana must be on the way. And look at Moffat. He looks absolutely exhausted after his stint at the wheel. It must be hard work.
At about one-third distance, the pit stops start in earnest. Most cars make three stops, some four, some more when trouble strikes. If all goes according to plan, tires are changed, fuel tanks filled, and drivers changed in less than a minute and a half.
Trouble is, if they happen a long way from the pit, the wheel might collapse from the strain. They're lucky. We've seen cars come into the pits with wheels shattered to pieces. Sometimes they don't even make it to the pit. This has probably cost them at least 2 minutes. Might have dropped them out of contention for a high place.
The cars rush in and out with monotonous but confusing regularity. The leading positions change constantly. While pit crews know to the millisecond the position of their charges, To the layman, the scene merely reinforces his view that he is witness to a bewilderingly fierce struggle. He knows, with half distance looming, that it is still anyone's race. There is still ample time for drama and disaster. Bathurst is notorious for changes in fortune. Races have been lost here within a few laps of the flag, lost because of a flat tire, or for the sake of a pint of petrol. But no one knows or dares think that this race might be different. As the spectacle wears on, it becomes clear that the well-tried and sorted Falcons of Moffat and Bond have consolidated in the lead. Several new model Taranas, still race fragile and yet to achieve full potential, are within striking distance, secure in the knowledge that there is still a long way to go, ready to swoop at the slightest sign of weakness. And there are signs that disaster could strike at any time. A soul-destroying way to quit a motor race. A warning to others of Bathurst's chilling ability to strike with sudden savagery. There'll be many more retirements, many more incidents before this day is out. So it goes. By race's end, nearly half the field will have quit in mute acknowledgement of Bathurst's toughness. Yet out of it will come better motor cars, because this is why this race is run, to improve the breed. And it happens. The third-placed Holden dealer Team Tirana of Harvey and Negus comes in, the driver distraught that Moffat may now be free of real pressure. It's an important break for the Ford driver, and he takes advantage of it, knowing full well the boot could be on the other foot. It is a cruel moment, but one that must be faced. In the quest for greater speed, a new and untried component has failed. Such is the price of development. No car becomes a consistent race winner overnight.
It was showing enormous potential, and there's no doubt that it was...
The decision is made to retire the car. No one likes it, but there is little to be achieved by resuming the race. Moffat's position is now strong. Victory is in sight, but he too has quit this race many times. The team members feel the bitter frustration of retirement. It's a common and shared emotion along pit row during this race. The simple facts are that there can only be one winner. But later, reason will tell them that it has all been worthwhile. Lessons have been learned. The lessons that had to be learned. The mood does not last long. The second team car's fourth place is increasingly important. Brock, the fastest qualifier, who led for a single lap before being struck down by tyre problems, cannot help. O'Brien and Harrop hurry through their stop. Time is crucial. They must get out again as soon as possible to lend support to Jansen and Perkins, who have come through to third to threaten the Fords.
There's drama in the pit. One of the mechanics has got petrol or something in his eyes.
And then precious seconds are lost. Fuel sloshes into the eyes of one of the mechanics. He stumbles for the pit counter in agony. The car is briefly forgotten. Just a few seconds delay, but of inestimable value to Moffat. The mechanic is quickly helped. Through it all, he curses the incident, as if feeling responsible for the delay. But it can't be helped. Refueling and retiring a race vehicle in a little over a minute is too hectic a business to expect that it will always go smoothly. The last stop of the Jansen-Perkins car. The machine is performing flawlessly, and it's attracting as much attention with its third place as the leaders. If they fail, the race will be theirs. But while Jansen muses on the possibilities, he knows he is equally vulnerable. Last time he worked his way up to third at Bathurst, he retired within sight of the flag. Still in fourth, O'Brien and Harrop have no thoughts of retirement. They mean to fight all the way to the checkered flag. So Jansen goes out again. Soon after, consternation for the Moffat team as the lead Falcon starts displaying signs of fatigue. The car is slowing. Moffat has another Falcon as a buffer between himself and Jansen, but the smoke billowing from the car is desperately worrying. If one Falcon can slow, so can two. The Turanas press as hard as they can. The second Falcon of Bond and Hamilton soon catches up with the slowing Moffat X car. The temptation to pass is strong, but team tactics prevail. Jansen's pit hopes for a last miracle, but it fails to eventuate. The Turana presses hard, it makes up lots of ground, but not enough. This race belongs to Moffat. It will be a fine win, achieved against the immense odds generated by this grueling endurance motor race.
One lap to go of Mount Panorama, and Colin Bond almost right into the slipstream now. Of Alan Moffat as they charge up there. They've only got one corner to negotiate, and all that money's theirs. And we're looking for them now. There they are, two abreast, over the last hump, down into the braking area now. Car number one just moves slightly ahead, and John Cummins, it's all yours.
Well, I think we'd all want to wish the winners a tremendous thanks for a wonderful day. It's been a long and hard race, and the winners deserve their victory very much. But the race was also made by those who came in places and further behind, and also by those who didn't even finish it. But all congratulations to Alan Moffat.
So, it's over for another year. Already, the morning after, Bathurst 1977 is in the history books. The lessons have been learned and noted. With motor racing, in terms of improving the breed, there is no looking back. Not here, of all places. Bathurst, New South Wales, Australia.